Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's live broadcast, Statin Myopathy, When Might It Be Autoimmune? I am Brenda Kelly Kim of Lab Roots, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We are delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by Lab Roots and sponsored by ANOVA Diagnostics. ANOVA Diagnostics is redefining autoimmunity by delivering solutions which anticipate the needs of the autoimmunity laboratory. ANOVA develops new biomarkers to enhance patient care and help your laboratory improve the efficiency and quality of testing. For more information, please visit www.anovadx.com. Before we begin, we have a few important announcements. This webcast is designed to be interactive, and we encourage you to ask questions during the event. You can submit questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can. You can enlarge the slide window by clicking on the screen icon in the lower right-hand corner of the slide window. If you have any technical problems viewing or hearing this presentation, please click on the support button at the top right of your presentation window or submit your problem through the green Q&A button lower left. I would now like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Lisa Christopher Stine. Dr. Christopher Stine is currently the director of Johns Hopkins Myositis Center. She is an associate professor of medicine and neurology. Dr. Christopher Stine's primary research focus is clinical research pertaining to inflammatory myopathies, specifically describing unique phenotypes, novel therapeutic approaches, and novel disease subsets among patients with inflammatory myopathies who are part of the growing cohort of over 1,500 patients evaluated clinically for confirmed or suspected muscle disease at the Myositis Center and who agree to be part of the Johns Hopkins Myositis database. Dr. Christopher Stine and her colleagues made the novel discovery of an autoimmune myopathy closely linked to statins. She has a continued interest in statins and their toxicities toward muscle, both as a direct muscle toxin as well as its contribution to autoimmune muscle injury. Dr. Christopher Stine?
Thank you so much for that great introduction. It is my pleasure and privilege to talk with you today about an emerging concept of statin myopathy as an autoimmune process. These are my disclosures. So our objectives today will be first to review what is currently known about statin myotoxicity, commonly known as statin myopathy. Next, I'd like to elucidate the clinical and pathological features of this newly described autoimmune myopathy that we believe is closely related to statin exposure. Next, I'll provide you with an overview of a new autoantibody, anti-HMGCR, and its clinical importance. We'll look at algorithms that might suggest how you could recognize statin-associated immune-mediated myopathy and when anti-HMGCR testing may be appropriate in clinical practice. And finally, we'll touch upon potential improvements in patient care outcomes with early recognition and treatment of this recently described entity. As a clinician, I like to start with the patient, and this is a real patient whom I saw back in 2009. So CP was a 58-year-old woman with a history of hyperlipidemia. She was first exposed back in 2004 to atorvastatin at high doses of 80 milligrams for 5 months. It is unclear why such a high dose was started at that time, and unfortunately, because there are scant medical records to review, we were only able to know that an ALT and an AST taken at that time was normal. Her CK was unknown. 5 months later, muscle pain occurs, and her atorvastatin is discontinued, but there is no mention of any muscle enzymes checked at that time. Next, in August of 2005, we note that her ALT and AST, which in addition to being liver-specific are also muscle-specific enzymes, were elevated, but her CK was unknown. By June of the following year, her ALT and her AST had normalized, and her CK was also noted to be normal at 116. The following year, May of 2007, a new statin is started. This time it's pravastatin, 40 milligrams, and she takes this for 3 months. Once again, within 3 months of starting pravastatin, she reports muscle pain, and pravastatin is also discontinued. There is no note of weakness at this point in her clinical course. In September of 2007, her ALT and her AST are noted to be elevated. This is 1 month after she notes the muscle pain. Her CK is also markedly elevated to around 1,897, a considerably above normal range, which at most labs is under 250. By January of 2008, her CK continues to rise. And by February, her muscle pain actually intensifies and weakness begins, despite the fact that she had never restarted a statin. Between February of 2008 and September of 2009, she becomes progressively weaker. Her muscle biopsy initially showed some patchy necrosis in the absence of an inflammatory infiltrate. She had an EMG, which was said to be inconclusive for muscle disease. Her CKs then rose dramatically to a high of 8,728. She saw multiple doctors who called her illness, quote, mysterious. None of them really believed that the statin could be to blame, given the fact that she had continual clinical progression of her muscle disease, despite the fact that the statin had been withdrawn. She was told, well, this doesn't appear to be autoimmune. There's no primary inflammation on muscle biopsy. No known myositis-specific autoantibodies were found in commercial testing laboratories. And thus, no treatment was offered because no one could conclusively come to a diagnosis. When she initiated her referral to our center, she wrote, all the doctors I've seen are puzzled. They've ruled out a lot of diseases because there is no muscle inflammation, but there is evidence of muscle damage. I'm hoping that you will see me, as I do not know how much worse my condition will get, and I do not want to end up in a wheelchair. If there is an answer for me. She strongly felt that the statin was to blame and sought input at our center. I told her that she came to us at the right time because we were just beginning to understand that there was a growing new entity associated with statin use that might likely applied to her. Let's look back first at statin myopathy clinical aspects. So, nonspecific muscle pain and weakness are actually more common than frank rhabdomyolysis or myopathy. And you all know that the incidence of the most common complaint of nonspecific muscle or joint pains in the absence of an elevated muscle enzyme actually doesn't differ significantly from placebo if we look at clinical trials. That's somewhere around 5% in those reported trials. If we look at those patients with markedly elevated CKs, those over 1,500, that is somewhere on the order of 1.6 cases per every 1,000 patients. So if we looked back at the 2010 use in the United States, for example, that would translate to around 70,000 cases per 44 million U.S. patients estimated to be taking statins at that point in time. Muscle symptoms and high serum muscle enzymes may persist even after statin withdrawal. And it was this particular entity that perplexed us at our own center, as this was a common complaint among patients that was really quite poorly understood. Let's take a step back a moment and look at cholesterol synthesis. Remember that cholesterol is formed with a combination of acyl-CoA and acetyl-acyl-CoA. They combine to form 3-hydroxy-3-methylglutaryl-CoA, better known as HMG-CoA. So HMG-CoA reductase, then, is the rate-limiting enzyme step in the cholesterol cascade. Remember that it is statins that inhibit this enzyme. We'll come back to this concept momentarily. So statin myotoxicity, as we understood it, as a self-limiting process and not an autoimmune process, was debated. One of the mechanisms of statin myotoxicity was perhaps that it altered, decreasing cholesterol altered myocyte membrane potential. Or perhaps the reduced ubiquinone, also known as coenzyme Q, disrupted mitochondrial function. And this is the reason why some people try to add back coenzyme Q to patients that exhibit toxicity from their statins. And finally, maybe these isoprenylated proteins, these intermediate proteins, the depletion of such activated apoptotic pathways. At the same time as we were trying to understand self-limited myotoxicity, statins and autoimmunity became an interesting subject. I was privileged to review the topic of statin autoimmunity about 8 years ago, and at that time I had commented that although statin myotoxicity was generally believed to be a non-inflammatory toxic myopathy, such as that I just showed you, there was growing experimental evidence that suggested that statin myopathy may, in fact, be triggered by an autoimmune reaction, or conversely, that statin use itself triggers an autoimmune process. But the precise mechanism of statin-induced immune reactions was really uncertain. There was some early evidence that linked statins to autoimmunity. They were known to have a direct immunomodulatory effect on T lymphocytes that perhaps promoted a shift of Th1 to Th2 immune response and then led to B cell hyperreactivity and production of pathogenic autoantibodies. And perhaps the specific statin binding site on T lymphocytes involved in selective inhibition of LFA1 had also been described, and perhaps this was implicated as well. There was also a question as to whether statins were associated with the traditional inflammatory myopathies that we understood, dermatomyositis, polymyositis, or inclusion body myositis. In fact, statins have been implicated in a host of autoimmune disease, notably dermatomyositis, and probably most notably systemic lupus, and even cutaneous lupus erythematosus. The mechanisms by which the drugs might induce autoimmunity was thought to involve the promotion of apoptosis, which led to exposure of neoantigens and then enhanced the innate immune response. Again, there was reports of both dermatomyositis and polymyositis-like syndromes persisting even after statins were withdrawn. This is just a brief report of cases of dermatomyositis and cholesterol-lowering agents. And I mostly show this to you to show you that the statin that was used was variable. At that time, pravastatin, simvastatin, lovastatin, and fluvastatin had all been reported, as well as the period of initiation of drug use to the onset of symptoms, so as little as 5 weeks to as much as 2 years before clinical syndromes became apparent. But we were seeing more than just the typical poly and dermatomyositis syndromes. There was something unique. I'll review for those of you less familiar with the way that we classify and characterize poly and dermatomyositis. So the Bowen and Peter diagnostic criteria have persisted since the mid-1970s. These 40-year-old criteria are the way that we currently classify these myopathies. So if you have symmetrical proximal muscle weakness, that would be at your hips and shoulder girdle, as well as elevated muscle enzymes, which can include CK or creatine kinase, as well as aldolase, or those transaminases, which we need to remember they're not only liver-specific, but also muscle-specific, or LDH. In addition to specific myopathic EMG abnormalities, typically an irritable myopathy, and typical changes on muscle biopsy, which I'll show you momentarily, if you have all four of those, you are said to have definite polymyositis. If you have only three of the top four, you are said to have probable polymyositis. Likewise, if you have a typical rash of dermatomyositis, which is that of a heliotrope or a rash on the eyelids, as well as that over the MCP joints or gut transpapules, those pathognomonic rashes plus three of the top four of these of this list would lead you to a diagnosis of definite dermatomyositis, and so on. So here is a brief muscle histology review. In the top left-hand corner here, you can see muscle histology that is normal. The muscle fibers are of equal shape and size. There is not much variation here, and you don't see lymphocytes. Over here, in contrast, is consistent with polymyositis, which shows primary inflammation, which is a normal muscle fiber surrounded by these lymphocytes, these inflammatory cells that are purple here. You can also see that there is both change in size and shape of the fibers. Down here, dermatomyositis is typified by a hallmark feature called perifascicular atrophy. While we don't see this on all biopsies, when we do, we think it is pathognomonic. And essentially, the myocytes become smaller as the fascicles approximate each other. Also, what is common in dermatomyositis is perivesicular inflammation, or the vessel as the primary target of the lymphocytes, which you can see here. So in general, dermatomyositis tends to have perivesicular inflammation, or vascular inflammation, as well as a perimesial distribution. Polymyositis, on the other hand, has an endomesial distribution of lymphocytes. So the idiopathic inflammatory myopathies, as I learned them and as many of us in training learned them, were polymyositis, dermatomyositis, and inclusion body myositis, as well as a host of other less known entities or those related to other connective tissue diseases. But shown here in red was an emerging new actor, something that we began to understand in around 2003 when this began to be written about in the medical literature, this idea of an immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy. And this was not polymyositis or dermatomyositis. You can see here, this is an example histologically of immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy. I think that you can see that there are basophilic staining cells, eosinophilic staining cells, and an obvious change in the size and shape of the fibers. There is necrosis, degeneration, and regeneration. And what there is a remarkable absence of those lymphocytes that you saw on the prior slides. So that is definitely not that. So necrotizing myopathy. On its own, it's a nonspecific histopathologic finding. It's associated with a host of conditions, something like muscular dystrophy, for example, even malignancy, toxic myopathies. So in other words, somebody that was exposed to a statin developed fulminant rhabdomyolysis, and you look at their muscle cells, in fact, they would have a necrotizing myopathy. The myopathy we're talking about today, however, is not that of an immediate toxic myopathy secondary to statins or another process. In fact, some of our own immune-mediated myopathies, those connected with other autoantibodies, such as that of JO1, for example, or a less familiar antibody called anti-signal recognition particle, or SRP, can have this finding on biopsy. Nevertheless, a substantial proportion of patients with necrotizing myopathies have none of these known associations. And that's what led us to be quite perplexed. This finding, in addition to noting that there was this growing literature of patients with statin exposure and a seemingly autoimmune process, led us to our observations that we'll talk about today. So for those of you who study closely muscle diseases and autoimmune muscle diseases, you're aware that there's a growing literature of myositis-specific autoantibodies. Some of them are named here. There are some dermatomyositis-specific antibodies as well as immune-mediated specific antibodies. What's important to note is that these autoantibodies seem to have a very close clinical manifestation associated with it. In other words, there's an autoantibody and clinical phenotype tight association. We see this, for example, in dermatomyositis, where an anti-MY2 antibody, the first on that list, is associated with a generally treatment-responsive myopathy that has more rash than muscle disease, for example, in a patient with dermatomyositis. In contrast, under the immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy autoantibody list here, we see anti-SRP, which I mentioned briefly before, signal recognition particle. This is a myopathy that looks clinically like polymyositis, but the muscle biopsy looks like I just showed you a necrotizing biopsy with a severe, acute, relatively treatment-resistant myopathy. We felt like there was something growing that was missing. We were seeing immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy seemingly without anti-SRP antibodies. So this led us to our discovery of a new autoantibody associated with necrotizing myopathies, which we called anti-200-100. We do have the privilege in our center of being able to screen prospectively our patients' serum samples to look for unique and known autoantibodies, and that's what we saw here. This finding, at the same time of noting that there was increased statin exposure in these patients, led us to be interested in trying to understand the connection between statins and this entity. So our initial study was approved by our local institutional review board. We had 454 consecutive patients at that point who had been referred to us for suspected or confirmed muscle disease. 225 of them had both available serum and muscle biopsy specimens available for our review. We ascertained their history and physical examination information, electromyogram and nerve conduction studies. We're privileged to be able to have MRI studies on the muscle of bilateral thighs of the majority of our patients. Pulmonary function testing was done because 30% of patients with inflammatory myopathies may also have pulmonary findings, something we do not see in this particular entity we're discussing today, however. malignancy screening, as this is quite important in patients with inflammatory myopathies, and then their standard laboratory evaluation. Antibody specificities, as I shared with you, were assessed by immunoprecipitation from 35S methionine-labeled HeLa cell lysates, and muscle biopsies were routinely evaluated for features of inflammation, regeneration, degeneration, necrosis, and any vacuoles. And the biopsies were stained for membrane attack complex, I'll show you that momentarily, MHC class 1, which was upregulated, but I do not share that data today, as well as endothelial cells, which I will show you. So looking at this graphically, we had 454 patients, 225 of them, with available samples for our study. 187 patients without predominant necrosis were found. In contrast, 38 patients with predominant necrosis were seen. 12 of those patients had known autoantibody associations or other diagnoses, but it was the remaining 26 patients who had no known myositis-specific antibody or other diagnosis to explain the necrotizing myopathy. And a novel autoantibody specificity, the one I showed you previously, to 200-100 kilodaltons, was found in 16 of these 26 patients, which represented 62% of these patients. Here you see sera precipitated from patients with necrotizing myopathy that are precipitating the 200-100 kilodalton proteins. On the left nine lanes, these are the sera that recognize that doublet, and on the right is our control sera, which did not immunoprecipitate this pair of proteins. The patient in the control lane had JO1-associated disease. What did the muscle biopsy features look like in this new entity? Well, endomesial or perivascular collections of inflammatory cells were seen in the paucity of patients to a very mild degree. There was mild or no denervation and no biopsy stained positive for abnormal glycogen or for amyloid. The small vessel blood vessels stained positive for the membrane attack complex. And MAC deposition was seen on non-necrotic myofibers. I think you could see that this is a muscle specimen from one of our patients that reveals MAC deposition on scattered non-necrotic fibers, and that's represented on the left panel by the red arrows. And you can see notable absence of membrane attack complex or MAC staining on endomesial capillaries on the right, represented by the white arrows. So this is growing evidence that this was an immune-mediated process. There was also abnormal capillary morphology in our patients, where the left represents a normal control muscle sample. And on the right, this is stained with anti-CD31, which is an endothelial cell marker. And you can see that there was abnormal morphology of those cells. Clinically, these patients were in their 50s. There were more women than men in the first cohort that we reviewed. There were 50% that were Caucasian. Proximal weakness was seen in all of our patients. High CK levels were initially seen, and the mean was around 10,000. I will say that since this original description, we are now seeing patients with a much more mild phenotype, and even those that might not raise their CK initially. And MRI evidence of muscle edema was seen in all of our patients. Irritable myopathy was seen on EMG in the vast majority. And interestingly, these were myopathies that hurt. Typically, we are told as trainees in rheumatology that inflammatory myopathies are thought to be painless. In fact, many of them seem to have pain associated with them. And these patients had considerable myalgias, but they were also weak. 50% of them also complained of arthralgias. They had considerable joint symptoms. And remarkably, 63% of them had considerable dysphagia, a very unique feature, especially with a typical statin myopathy you would not normally see. And the minority, only two, had Raynaud's phenomenon. And they responded to immunosuppression. So when we treated these patients, assuming based on their biopsy features and other clinical features that they indeed had an immune-mediated myopathy, these patients responded to suppression quite well. There was complete or near complete response in the initial cohort of 64% of them, a partial response in 36%. Soberingly, many relapsed with taper. As of the writing of this paper, 50% had not relapsed to date, but unfortunately, as you follow these patients forward, there is some evidence that continual treatment is needed in at least some of these patients. What was very intriguing is that statin use was quite heavily represented in this unique group of patients. The duration of use before the onset of muscle symptoms was variable, some from only a few weeks to as much as 84 months, and the average duration was 31 months prior to reporting any muscle symptoms. So this was not an immediate feature of statin use in many of these patients. The statin that was used was variable, although I'll provide some updated information showing you that there may be some statin specificity. And then the length of time between discontinuing the statin and muscle biopsy was anywhere between 1 to 14 months, with an average of 5 months before these patients were ever biopsied. And here is an example showing you that increased statin use was, in fact, statistically different in this unique group of patients versus our dermatomyositis and our polymyositis patients, particularly those over the age of 50. So while there was 83% use of statins in our 200-100 novel autoantibody group, only 25% and 37% of dermato and polymyositis patients respectively use statins. I want to be clear that there is a bit of a confusion here in that the 200-100 patients were not all statin exposed. There is a small percentage of them that are statin naive, but it was their potent statin exposure that led us to try to understand further why the statin seemed to be associated with the physiology of this disease. So our conclusions from our first study showed us that patients with the anti-200-100 kilodalton specificity represented a distinct subgroup of necrotizing myopathy patients who would have previously been characterized as myositis autoantibody negative. They would have been myositis-specific autoantibody negative. This 200-100 kilodalton may be a subunit of a protein complex. And then there was evidence to support an immune-mediated myopathy responsive to immunosuppression. Again, as I told you, the most intriguing part of this discovery was that statin exposure was clearly enhanced in this patient population. So our next task at hand was to try to identify the autoantigens recognized by these 200-100 autoantibodies. Okay, let's take a step back and think about our patient. So Ms. P is then believed to have this phenotype consistent with a statin-associated immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy. We feel that she at least deserves a trial of treatment with prednisone and azathioprine, and she does respond partially to that, but underwent a second biopsy 4 months later after her initial visit with us because of the unclear features on the first biopsy, and at this point, this showed widespread necrotizing myopathy in the absence of primary inflammation. We eventually added IVIG, and she had an excellent clinical response. Within 4 months of starting this, her strength was normal, both proximally and distally, and her CK normalized from its peak of nearly 9,000 to a remarkable 43. In terms of functional status, Ms. P was now able to ambulate on her own. She did not have to be assisted upstairs by her husband and gained greater independence and was quite pleased with her own progress. So the presence of 200-100 autoantibodies were confirmed in our research laboratory, but we were not the first to recognize a seemingly statin-associated autoimmune myopathy. There were 8 cases previously reported from an Australian cohort that investigated muscle pathology of patients with persistent myopathy despite statin withdrawal. Like our patients, all of them had myofiber necrosis, and only 3 had an inflammatory infiltrate. In all cases, there was diffuse or multifocal upregulation of MHC class 1 expression, even in non-necrotic fibers, similar to what we have also seen here. Progressive improvement occurred in 7 of their 8 cases after beginning prednisolone and methotrexate, and they had the great experience of having 1 spontaneous regression, something we really have not seen in our own cohort. Likewise, in a New England cohort, 25 patients from 2 neuromuscular centers from the years of 2000 to 2008 were followed and met the following criteria. Very similarly, they had proximal muscle weakness occurring during or after treatment with their statins. They had elevated CK, persistence of weakness, and elevated muscle enzymes despite the discontinuation of statin. I hope you're seeing the pattern here. Improvement with immunosuppressive agents, and finally, muscle biopsies showing necrotizing myopathy in the absence of significant inflammation. Okay, back to our mystery. So our colleagues were seeing this, we were seeing this, and now the thought was that we are reasoning that a statin-associated autoimmune myopathy with this 200-100 autoantibody complex was thought to provide a model system for defining a mechanistic relationship between drug exposure, or environmental exposure, if you will, and developing a specific autoimmune response. So, as we said, identifying that autoantigen targeted by the immune response was that critical first step. And there was an important clue. This slide shows the upregulated expression of the 200 kilodalton and 100 kilodalton autoantigens by a statin. Here, the statin is mevinolin. So our group previously demonstrated that sera from a group of patients with immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy immunoprecipitate approximately 200 to 100 kilodalton proteins from these radiolabeled HeLa cell extracts. And again, as we said, given the strong association of statin use with the development of these antibodies, HeLa cells were then labeled with 35S methionine cysteine after pre-treating for 24 hours with either mevinolin or with a vehicle, and here that vehicle was DMSO alone. I think you can see that there is increased levels, in fact, threefold, of both the 200 and 100 kilodalton proteins immunoprecipitated from the mevinolin-treated cells, demonstrating that levels of these autoantigens are indeed upregulated by the statins. So again, we demonstrated that statin exposure upregulates the expression of the 200-100 kilodalton autoantigens. And we made the leap that given that statin exposure is known to increase expression of many proteins, including HMGCR, it was investigated whether this enzyme may in fact be the 100 kilodalton autoantigen, as it weighs about 97 kilodaltons. And in fact, the identity of the 100 kilodalton autoantigen was confirmed by precipitating in vitro translated HMGCR protein. So to be clear, our new antibody, the 200-100 autoantibody, was in fact anti-HMGCR. So Dr. Andrew Mammon and Dr. Cassiola Rosen, who performed these experiments, showed that serum from the 200-100 patients specifically recognized the intracellular catalytic domains of HMGCR. Again, there was some experimental evidence that suggests that the 200 kilodalton protein was a co-precipitant or perhaps a dimer of HMGCR protein. And all 16 of the original 200-100 patient samples previously identified by immunoprecipitation were positive for HMGCR, in contrast to none of the dermato or IBM patients that we tested in our cohort. And this finding was published in Arthritis and Rheumatism in 2011. So we once again looked at our cohort. At this point, we had 750 patients, and anti-HMGCR autoantibodies were found by ELISA in 45 or 6% of the patients that were referred to our Center for Suspected Myopathy. This, in fact, was a considerable number of patients that we saw and one of the most prominent autoantibodies we were seeing. 92% of patients over the age of 50 had statin exposure. So the vast majority of patients that have this autoantibody expression are statin exposed. The prevalence of statin use in the anti-HMGCR patients, again, was significantly higher than age-matched patients, including those of dermatomyositis and polymyositis and IBM. So just to be clear, there are some differences between those patients who are anti-HMGCR positive, who are naive to statins, and those that are exposed. Patients without statin exposure are clinically indistinguishable, except they tend to be a bit younger, they tend to have a slightly higher CK, and more often they were African American than Caucasian, and there was a slight predominance to seeing a little bit more traditional lymphocytes or inflammatory infiltrate on their muscle biopsy, although that was not the predominant feature. Okay. Here is statin myopathy as we now know. So remember, cholesterol synthesis, there's a long cascade toward cholesterol. And remember that HMG-CoA reductase is the rate-limiting step of this cascade. Statins inhibit HMG-CoA reductase, decreasing cholesterol production. Now, what was confusing to me is that if we were limiting or inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase, how, in fact, were we actually making that immunogenic? Although that's still unclear, it is known that when cholesterol is decreased, in fact, HMG-CoA reductase is potently increased. There's a feedback mechanism that when we decrease our cholesterol, our body says make more, and the rate-limiting enzyme goes up. So something about this suggests that it is either conformationally changed or increased, and it becomes immunogenic to the immune system. Exactly how that immunogenicity is determined is still unclear. Okay, so then why does the myopathy persist when we take the statin away? Surely if you withdraw the inciting agent, shouldn't the muscle disease just go away? Well, there was prior work from my colleague, Dr. Cashiella Rosen, and colleagues that had shown that regenerating muscle cells express high levels of autoantigens. So in this case, anti-HMGCR, which may sustain the immune response even after statins are discontinued. How does that apply to these patients clinically? Well, recall that regenerating cells are quite abundant in immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy, and they appear to be the repair mechanism for muscle injury in this instance. So can you see that this would then provide an endless supply of autoantigen? It is this repair mechanism that becomes the generator for a forward flow of constant immunogenicity. So to directly examine HMGCR expression in vivo, our group stained muscle biopsy sections with polyclonal HMGCR antibodies. Because as we just said, Dr. Cashiella Rosen and her colleagues had already reported that other myositis-associated and specific autoantibodies were expressed at high levels in muscle cells with features of regeneration sections. So these were then co-stained with NCAM, which is known marker of muscle regeneration. In muscle biopsy specimens showing normal features, both HMGCR and NCAM are expressed at low levels, and you can see that here in the lower panels. Through D through F. In contrast, NCAM-positive fibers were prominent in muscle biopsy samples obtained from anti-HMGCR-positive patients who had not been exposed to statins for months to years, interestingly. Remarkably, most of those NCAM-positive fibers were also expressed high levels of HMGCR, and so that is seen here, so in A through C. So there was co-localization, if you will, of NCAM-positive fibers, those regenerating fibers, and high levels of HMGCR. These findings provide strong evidence for an in vivo confirmation that regenerating muscle fibers from an anti-HMGCR-positive patient expresses high levels of the HMGCR. So you'll ask, what is the prevalence of these antibodies in statin-exposed and statin-unexposed patients in the general population? My colleague, Dr. Mammon, screened the atherosclerosis risk in communities, or ARIC, cohort. There was a subsample in that cohort that listed 881 statin-naive subjects. 763 of them were current statin users, and 322 had no prior statin exposure. By ELISA testing, none of these patients were anti-HMGCR positive. Are anti-HMGCR antibodies found in patients with self-limited statin intolerance? So is this any different than the typical statin myopathy as we previously understood it? So in fact, 98 patients with familial hypercholesterolemia due to the LDLR gene mutation were screened. 51 of these had intolerance to statins that even required them to stop their therapy. 33% of them reported weakness. 61% of them had some muscle pain. 20% of them had elevated CK or myoglobinuria. But these were patients with an otherwise self-limited disease where stopping the statin seemed to stop their disease and they did not have further symptoms. 47 of these patients had been on maximum dose statin therapy. And none of these 98 were positive for this new autoantibody. So we think that anti-HMGCR appears to be highly specific. It's found in only patients with autoimmune myopathy, to our knowledge. It does not seem to be found in those with the usual, self-limited, and more common statin intolerance. In patients with statin-associated muscle symptoms, a negative anti-HMGCR ELISA test seems to predict self-limited disease and helps us tell the difference between the two. So you're asking, is there immunogenetic risk factors for developing these antibodies? In fact, there is. If we HLA type the anti-HMGCR subjects versus their controls, HLA-DR11 is seen in Caucasians to be statistically different, considerably higher, 70% versus 18% of controls in our subjects with HMGCR antibodies. Likewise, in African Americans, this difference is also significant, 88% versus 21%. If fine mapping is done, DRB1-1101 is very strongly associated with the development of association of anti-HMGCR antibodies. Fine mapping shows that there's an odds ratio, remarkably, of 24.5 in Caucasians and a remarkable 56.5 in African Americans, showing that this is one of the strongest links between an HLA allele and an autoimmune disease. You might ask whether titers of this autoantibody correlate with muscle strength and muscle enzymes. We identified 55 anti-HMGCR subjects with at least one visit. 40 statin-exposed and 15 statin-unexposed patients were examined. And we measured their autoantibody levels, their CK, and their strength over time. And this is just meant to show you that there are similar initial features of statin-exposed and those who are statin-naive. Remember that the vast majority are statin-exposed, but there is a statin-naive proportion of patients with inflammatory myopathies that is also seen. They had a similar titer at entry. Their CK levels did not differ significantly. And a composite strength index for their arm abduction and hip flexion did not seem to differ between the patient populations either. Here's a graphical representation following 17 subjects longitudinally for 5+ visits over 26 months. If we just look at one example of a statin-exposed patient on the left and a statin-naive patient on the right, I think you can see here that both the HMGCR titer, which decreases with time, as does the muscle enzyme. In contrast, the patient on the right, the statin-naive patient, has no consistent association with their CK titer or with their CK level or their HMGCR titer over time. That again is shown here in our results, in which the anti-HMGCR titers do decrease over time in our statin-exposed patients versus the statin-naive patients that seemingly have no decrease in their titer over time. Likewise, the serum CK levels decrease in our statin-exposed patients coincident with their titers decreasing, and their arm strength and hip strength improve. That is not seen in our statin-naive group. So who's at risk for anti-HMGCR-associated myopathy? We recently looked at this and presented this in abstract form at the recent American College of Rheumatology meeting. We looked at our patients from May of 2002 to January of 2014, all of the patients evaluated at our center who were enrolled in our longitudinal cohort. Serum and DNA samples were available for over 1,000 of those patients, and they were included in our analysis if they met the Bohan and Peter criteria for definite or probable polymyositis or dermatomyositis. HMGCR autoantibodies were tested via immunoprecipitation as well as ELISA testing. And the patients in the comparator group were selected from the myositis cohort if they were HMGCR negative, fulfilled the Bohan and Peter criteria, and they had a detailed documented statin history. So to be clear, we are comparing HMGCR positive statin exposed patients to those patients who are also statin exposed but do not express the HMGCR antibody. So a retrospective chart review from the time of the first clinic visit until January 2014 or the last clinical encounter was performed. We had 77 anti-HMGCR positive patients. 19 of those were statin-naive. 39 statin-exposed patients were negative for HMGCR autoantibodies. So the data was compared then between those 58 patients, 77 minus 19 is 58 statin-exposed HMGCR patients, and 39 statin-exposed HMGCR negative patients. Those that had the autoantibody to HMGCR were slightly older, but otherwise seemed to have similar baseline characteristics. This is a large clinical table, but I point to the fact that there was a significant association with type 2 diabetes mellitus, which was seen prior to the institution of statin or to prednisone therapy, that was notable in the anti-HMGCR autoantibody group compared to the HMGCR negative statin exposed group. I'm often asked, what about specific statins? And this is difficult to determine because a lot of this data is retrospectively reviewed. Of those patients in our myositis cohort with known statin exposure, the patients, 74.2% of them, or 72 of them, had a history of exposure to atorvastatin at some point in the past. If we look at the difference between the positive group, HMGCR positive group, to the HMGCR naive group, 51 patients, or nearly 88% in the HMGCR positive group, had been exposed to atorvastatin, compared to only 21 patients, or 54%, in the anti-HMGCR negative group. No other difference was seen between the groups with the exception of more simvastatin exposure in the HMGCR negative statin exposed group. So, what other findings? We found a higher prevalence of type 2 diabetes, as I showed you, an increased exposure to atorvastatin, as we just saw, prior to their symptom onset. And compared to statin-exposed HMGCR patients, their patients also had a similar number of cancer, decreased prevalence of ILD in our HMGCR positive group, and were more likely to be treated with IVIG or rituximab, which might suggest that they were a potentially more aggressive, it required more aggressive treatment, and they may be a treatment-resistant phenotype. HMGCR-positive statin-exposed patients had a higher mean CK value and greater hip flexor weakness compared to statin-exposed HMGCR-negative patients. Finally, adjusted for HMGCR antibody status, multiple regressions showed no significant associations between individual statins and measures of CK and proximal weakness specifically. Why does this matter for your clinical practice? The takeaway message today for sure is that in addition to a self-limited toxic myopathy, my patient was right. Statins seem to be associated with an autoimmune myopathy, which is progressive, even when the statin is stopped. Most cases of statin-associated immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy appear to respond to immunosuppression, but note that combination therapy is often necessary. Prednisone in combination with one or more immunosuppressants is unfortunately the exception rather than the rule in our experience to date. When might we consider testing for such autoantibodies? In those patients with persistently elevated, maybe beyond 3 months, elevated CK, aldolase, or ALT, in the absence of other known cause despite statin cessation, muscle symptoms, either weakness or even myalgia persisting beyond those initial 12 weeks after the statin is stopped, regardless of the muscle enzyme. As I said earlier, we're seeing a little bit more of a milder phenotype, less likely to have markedly elevated CKs, and perhaps this entity exists in even lower CKs than we previously suspected. If the patient has dysphagia, this is a clinical hallmark that suggests a more ominous process, and this may be another example of when this testing may be appropriate. EMG abnormalities, either an irritable or non-irritable myopathy, or muscle edema seen on an MRI with no alternative explanation, including a workup for a specific known myositis antibody, such as JO1, as we talked about, in statin-exposed and even those statin-naive patients alike. Finally, a muscle biopsy that shows necrosis with little or no inflammation in the absence of clinical rhabdomyolysis, which you might expect to see in statin-associated toxicity that is self-limited, in those patients who are statin users. So we'll end our discussion today with a quick quiz. So which finding is not associated with an immune-mediated statin myopathy? A, is it a necrotizing myopathy on biopsy? B, proximal weakness? C, a markedly elevated CK? D, CD8 cells present in the endomysium? Well, answer A is incorrect. Remember, necrotizing myopathy is indeed seen almost exclusively in statin-associated immune myopathy. Proximal weakness, no, these patients with statin-associated immune myopathy generally do present with proximal weakness and look clinically similar to polymyositis. Markedly elevated CK, well, one could say that this is not 100% incorrect, as I've told you, that sometimes we see lower CK. But in general, highly elevated muscle enzymes persisting after statin withdrawal is generally seen with statin-associated immune myopathy. So our correct answer then is CD8 positive cells. These are not seen. Remember, in statin-associated immune myopathy, a necrotizing myopathy is seen. And we believe that there is likely a relative paucity of typical inflammatory lymphocytes. Okay, your second and last question. A 74-year-old woman presents with new onset proximal weakness of a few weeks duration and elevated CPK levels. She's been on a statin for at least 10 years and denies any myalgias or rash. What do you recommend? Do you continue with her current medication as this drug is unlikely to be statin-related given the length of time on the drug? B, hold the statin and commence workup with an EMG biopsy and antibodies testing for HMGCR. C, begin prednisone as this appears to be an inflammatory myopathy similar to polymyositis. Or D, in this age group, malignancy-associated myositis is more prevalent and cancer workup should be done first. Well, given her current medications, as continuing with her current medications would be incorrect. We know that statin-associated immune myopathy can occur at any point in treatment, even after years of use, and we do recommend you discontinue the statin. Holding the statin and beginning workup with EMG biopsy and anti-HMGCR antibody is correct at this time. Holding the statin as the workup is done is appropriate in the compatible presentation to avoid exposure to a possible trigger. Beginning with prednisone, as this appears to be an inflammatory myopathy similar to polymyositis, we don't do this first, and certainly why we would do this, although it may be needed, if the statin is not stopped, symptoms are likely to progress. And malignancy workup, well, this is incorrect, and although malignancy workup should certainly be done simultaneously in a patient with weakness and suspected statin myopathy, stopping the statin, we believe, is the imperative first step. So with that, I would like to give thanks to my colleagues. No science is done in a vacuum, and this was 100% a team effort. Shown here, in addition to myself, is Dr. Andrew Mammon and Dr. Cassiola Rosen, who also did a majority of the work on this project. Dr. Anthony Rosen, my mentor, is not featured on this slide, but is also prominent in this work as well. And these are the rest of my colleagues who I'm privileged to work with at the Myositis Center, including neurologists, pulmonologists, and rheumatologists. Finally, I would like to thank my team of investigators and, most importantly, all of our myositis patients with which this research and novel findings would not be possible. My work is supported by grants from NIAMS and also supported by generous philanthropic funds. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for that informative presentation. Before we get started on the question and answer session, I would just like to remind our audience how to submit questions. You can submit questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. In addition, if you have any trouble hearing or seeing this presentation, you can also type your question in there. And let me just see what our first question is. Do we have Dr. Stine? All right, I'll just be pulling up those questions in one moment when we have. Okay, thank you for that. I think we have to wrap it up now. We're going to be answering questions via email at this point. We're having some technical issues, but questions will be answered via email by Dr. Christopher Stine. We are out of time at this point. I want to thank the audience for their interesting questions and participation in today's event. I would also like to thank our sponsor, Inova, for making today's educational webcast possible. Today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through June 2015. You'll receive an email from LabRoots alerting you to when this webcast will be available for replay. And we invite you to forward that announcement to your colleagues who may have missed today's live event.